Wake up! Ramadan is here!
Take the 10-day Ramadan prep challenge.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam al-asliman kathira thumma ma ba'd. My dear brothers and sisters everywhere in the Muslim world around the globe, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah and Ramadan Mubarak to all of you. This is actually a Quran weekly broadcast. Alhamdulillah, today we're doing it from the Valley Ranch Masjid in Irving, Texas, and we're honored, alhamdulillah, to be part of this beautiful program, this beautiful Ramadan preparation for the beautiful month of Ramadan. My simple message this evening to you, all of you, inshallah, is very simple, and that is to remember, just to remember, that you will never be too ready for the month of Ramadan. Regardless how much you try, Ramadan deserves much more than what you can imagine, you can think. Regardless of how much you think that you have done enough to get ready and prepared for the month of Ramadan, Ramadan deserves much more, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. So always remember that you are never too ready for the month of Ramadan. Ramadan for us, alhamdulillah, Muslims, it's an annual opportunity to revisit our goals in this life. It's a reminder for all of us. Every time we come to this season, we see people, alhamdulillah, start now getting prepared, trying to start their, adjusting their schedule. They know they're going to have to spend some of their nights in the masjid, longer, maybe hours in the masajid. During the day, they're going to be extremely exhausted, tired, and now it's in the summer. So they would love to revisit their goals and adjust their programs accordingly. So therefore, it's very, very, a very exclusive opportunity for us Muslims, alhamdulillah. Every single year we get this blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal to live and survive until we live this new actually month of Ramadan. With every year that comes when Ramadan begins, as Muslims we always feel that this, we are still underachieving what we're supposed to be achieving in the month of Ramadan. And I guarantee you, one of you, I'm one of you as well, that we all have that feeling that unfortunately I should have done more, I could have done better in Ramadan, and every year as we think that we're prepared for it, at the end of the month we regret so much of the time that we spend wasting and we thought that we're doing it, you know, and benefiting from it. But unfortunately, again, there is always inshallah chance for improvement for every single Ramadan. And my talk with you, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, for this evening is about the art of excelling in Ramadan. How can we not repeat the same mistakes over and over again in the month of Ramadan? Don't expect me in this presentation to give you a full program, meaning to wake up such and such hour before Fajr, prepare yourself with wudu, qiyam al-layl, adhkar, suhoor, and then Fajr in the masjid and spending the time after Fajr. I'm not going to give you those detailed programs because each and every one of you, they know that they have different responsibilities and circumstances. You can write your own program or schedule the way it fits your own circumstances. What I'm going to share with you, inshallah ta'ala, 10 points that will help you reach excellence in the month of Ramadan. Excellence is excellence. And therefore, when we talk about excellence, we're going to have to use the same methodology. All the experts in this field of excelling have been talking about, whether it's in business, whether it's in lifestyle, whether it's in achieving in school, anywhere. It is the same thing, because excellence indeed is excellence. And inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala, I will share with you principles. How to reach success in the month of Ramadan, 10 points, bismillah, now start taking your notes. Number one, point one, to help you excel in the month of Ramadan, inshallah, azza wa jal, is to have the hunger for success. Have the hunger for success. You know, Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, one day was asked about the medicine that would help people to memorize the hadith and the ilm and the knowledge. He said, la a'lam, I have no knowledge of anything, any medicine that helps, other than Nahmat al-Rajul wa Kathrat al-Nadar. Nahmat al-Rajul means the ardent desire, the burning desire to memorize and learn that subject, whether it's hadith, whether it's science, anything that you do, including month of Ramadan. If you truly and really have the ardent desire, the burning desire, that hunger to succeed in the month of Ramadan, then you will achieve it, inshallah ta'ala. Even statistically speaking, the ulama and the scholars and scientists, they say that whatever expectation you have for yourself, most likely 80% of that expectation you're going to achieve. So if your expectation is success, you're going to achieve at least 80% of that actually expectation. And if you expect less than success, 80% you're going to achieve that, which is less basically than success. Why? Because you prepare yourself for that. So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala excelled in that field because he had that ardent desire, that burning desire to learn, and the hunger for success. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, he was a very young man when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. But the amount of ilm and knowledge he collected in the few years after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away made him the top of his field. He became the expert in the interpretation of the Quran and the expert in the reports about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. He once was asked, how were you able to collect all this knowledge in such a very short time? He said, بِلِسَانٍ سَأُولٍ وَقَلْبِ الْعَقُولِ, because I had inquisitive tongue and a heart that always comprehends. Basically, he had the ardent desire and the hunger to succeed in this field, and he never wasted his time. رضي الله تعالى عنه وارضاه. Same thing in Ramadan. Ramadan is going to come as an opportunity. And you should not make failure an option in Ramadan. Never give yourself an exit to fail in Ramadan. Many people, they usually start with the month of Ramadan with a hope inshallah to succeed, and then they start giving themselves excuses, whether they're legitimate excuses or not. But once you give yourself an excuse to fail, you're going to lose success. Because eventually you start psychologically heading towards that direction of failing in the month of Ramadan. So never give yourself that excuse, and always have that hunger to succeed in the month of Ramadan, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Point number two, set your goals. And when you set your goals, you make sure that these goals are very high and lofty goals. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He created us, He created us for a purpose, and that's to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in order to succeed in worshiping Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal, He, as He said, هَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ, that He guided you to two paths, the path of success and the path of failure. And in order to help us even to achieve the path of success subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave us the ultimate goal that we should really pursue and should achieve in our life, and that is to reach Al-Firdaws Al-A'la. Many ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَسَابِعُ, which means race, وَسَارِعُ, rush, vibe. So you all compete with each other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفِي ذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ, and let those who would like to vie and compete in this, in such a thing to compete. So eventually for the Jannah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is helping us, setting our goals for us, and making the goal to be Jannah al-Firdaws, al-Firdaws al-A'la. So by hitting that high, actually lofty goal, you will achieve it inshaAllah ta'ala by pursuing it. And even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he met the Ansar radiallahu ta'ala anhum, when they came in the second Bay'at al-Aqaba, the one they gave the pledge to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to support him, which led to the immigration of the Muhajireen to Medina. Then when the Muhajireen, they gave their pledge to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they asked him, they said, Ya Rasulullah, what do we get out of this? It means, what do we expect out of this from you? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Al-Jannah. He gave them that the ultimate goal that you're going to get, it's going to be Al-Jannah, meaning something from me, I give you nothing. I have nothing to give you. But you're going to get for what you're doing, what you're committing for, you're going to get Al-Jannah. That is your ultimate goal and should be a very high and lofty goal. Ramadan is the same thing. So when you start Ramadan, you're going to have to commit yourself to that. You're going to have to set your goals. And when you set your goals, you set them as high as you can. So if you want to do Khatmat al-Quran, you need to make a higher goal, not just once. Why don't you make it two, three, five? If you already, alhamdulillah, been doing that already, then set to a higher goal of finishing the Quran from cover to cover. If your part of your goals in Ramadan is to achieve, inshallah, righteousness and taqwa, then you're going to have to start making plan on how you could reach to that level of taqwa and righteousness, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, by adding more good deeds to your schedule. If part of your goals is to achieve Qiyam al-Layl every single night in the masjid with Taraweeh, then you do so. You commit to that. If you want to pray Maghrib or the five daily prayers, so whatever goals you had in the past Ramadan, you're going to have to set your goals to be higher than last year. At least, what you can get out of this, at least, if you a little bit you fell short from achieving these high, lofty goals, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala, they're definitely going to be higher than the goals you had last year. So even if you fall short, when you have very high, lofty goals, you will fall short, but still higher than the last year, inshallah. Next, point number three. Build confidence in the month of Ramadan. And what does that mean? Some people, they come with Ramadan with high expectation for themselves. They say, inshallah, this year, I'm going to finish the Quran 10 times. I'm going to make sure to pray Qiyamul Layl night prayer with the Imam from the beginning of the month until the end. I will not miss Takbiratul Ihram. They commit so many things for the month of Ramadan. However, other people might discourage them. You need to build confidence and not listen to anybody else. Build confidence that you can really achieve these goals. Regardless of how much time you have, you're going to set a plan and set a strategy on how to achieve these goals, and then inshallah build confidence that you can do that in the month of Ramadan. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu ta'ala, he also was a very young man at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard from people that Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As used to give khatma, used to make khatma, which means he used to finish the Quran every single night. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, surprised how could a young man like him achieve such a great achievement. However, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to him and he said, listen, basically what you're doing, alhamdulillah, is righteous and good deeds. But he told him, however, you should do the Quran in 1 month. That's besides Ramadan, by the way. Ramadan is an exclusive occasion where you could do more, inshallah ta'ala. But besides, outside Ramadan, the Prophet told him, try to finish the Quran once every month. قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي أَطِيقُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ I can achieve more than this. He had confidence in himself that he can do more than that. The Prophet said, okay then, do it in 1 week. He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي أَطِيقُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ I can achieve better than that. The Prophet then he told him, okay fine, we do it every 3 days, every 3 nights. He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ I can do better than this. The Prophet said, there is nothing better than this. If you're going to be reciting the Quran in less than 3 nights, says you're going to eventually going to be rushing into it and will not benefit from it a lot. Ramadan is a special occasion. And that's why the ulama, they say this hadith might apply outside Ramadan. But in Ramadan, you can do more than that, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. If you can achieve more than 10 khatmas in Ramadan, that means you do that very quickly, every 3 days. You do it once. Even if you could do more than this, would be a great, inshallah, achievement. That would be actually your goal. And build confidence that you can achieve that. Abdullah ibn Abbas, revisiting the stories of Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala, who was that young man who after the Prophet ﷺ passed away was still a teenager. He had a companion, an Ansari companion. He used to go and seek knowledge with him. So his young companion, the Ansari, he thought that this is going to be like a far journey for them. He says, listen, I mean, who is going to waste his time and come to listen to someone like you, being young at the time? They didn't expect that someone would come and listen to them. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, I left him and had not listened to him. And I continued pursuing my journey in seeking knowledge. Eventually, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he became the great leader and the great scholar we all know. His friend, Ansari, one day he passed by the masjid, seeing the hundreds and thousands of First of all, I want you to learn that our ulama, they keep saying, Al-Qasasu Tuhaful Jannah, which means stories and tales are actually like the gems of paradise. You know, when you hear a story, you enjoy it so much because you can relate yourself to it. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in the divine book, the Quran, Allah azza wa jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ, that we send to you the best al-qasas, the best of stories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relate the best stories to us. And at the end of the story of Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the translation, there is in their stories instruction for men in you with understanding. So were they sent for what? قَالَ تَعَالَى مَا كَانَ حَدِيثًا يُفْتَرَى. It wasn't a lie, it wasn't a tale invented. It was a real story, but a confirmation of what we sent before it, a detailed exposition of all things, and a guide and a mercy to any such as believe. So therefore, when you learn from the successful and learn from the best, inshaAllah ta'ala, that will encourage you. It will raise your morale and spirit, and you can see that achieving all these great goals that you can do in Ramadan has been done by people before you. And the Sahaba radiallahu, the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum wardahum, were the best example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those who followed them are also the best example for us after the month after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So check the stories of the successful in Ramadan. How did they succeed? What did they do? How they relate themselves to the month of Ramadan in the best way that you can relate yourself to it, inshaAllah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. My recommendation is that you go and you check some of the biographies of the people, of the ulama, the great scholars, and how they spend their time in Ramadan. See if you can achieve some of their achievements, inshaAllah ta'ala, in fasting, in memorization of the Quran, reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Qiyamul Layl, and other good deeds as well. Remember, keep these stories with you throughout the month of Ramadan. Every time you feel you're getting weaker and weaker, go back again to these stories and read them more. Remind yourself and move on, inshaAllah ta'ala, to the next level. Point number 6 in the art of excelling in the month of Ramadan. Be in the company of the successful one. The previous point was about people that you learn about from history. We learn about in books of seerah, in books of akhlaq and fiqh and so on. So you learn about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, style in Ramadan, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. But all of this, for many people, they say, Yahi, this is just theoretical. I read about it, I enjoy it, but I don't know if we can really achieve something like this. Why not then look for people around you in your own community, in your own masjid, who can help you achieve these lofty goals? Why not? Look for them. You will definitely find one or two people around you that not so many people maybe recognize them as good, inshallah, example for you during the month of Ramadan. You should go and look for those people. Remember, your companions in Ramadan can help you go high, alhamdulillah, in goals, or maybe take you, actually pull you down, because habits are very contagious. You learn from people the good and the bad, and the ugly. So if you would like to learn the good, you're going to have to associate yourself with the good ones. If you want to learn how to achieve more in Ramadan, then you're going to have to look for high achievers in the month of Ramadan. Going with people who are less achievers, low achievers in Ramadan, going to result in you adopting the same habits. Why? Because it's contagious. And because you see those people achieving that much, you feel good about yourself and with your low achievements. But if you always associate yourself with good achievers and high achievers, bi-idhnillah, you always go high in your goals. The Prophet ﷺ says, مَثَلُ الْجَلِيسِ الصَّالِحِ وَالْجَلِيسِ السُّوءِ كَمَثَلِ حَامِلِ الْمِسْكُ وَنَفِخِ الْكِيلِ. The example of the good companion, the bad companion, just the example of the one who sells perfume and عطر, and the blacksmith. So you see, the حَامِلِ الْعُطَرِ, حَامِلِ الْمِسْكِ, is the one who would, you will achieve from them one of three things. إِمَّا أَنْ يُحْذِيَ, he might give you something good for free. وَإِمَّا أَنْ تَبْتَعَ مِنْ, or we might buy something by asking yourself and get that benefit from them. وَإِمَّا أَنْ تَجِدَ رِيحًا طَيِّبًا, at least you're going to get nice smell from them. Means the influence will be still good. وَنَافِخِ الْكِيلِ, the blacksmith, when he used the fire and smoke, when you visit their shop and their store, as they start blowing the smoke, the Prophet says, إِمَّا نِحْرَقَ ثِيَابَكَ, the end result of this is they might burn your clothes, a spark that's going to fly, catch your clothes and then burn it, or at least تَجْدَ رِيحًا خَبِيثًا, that's going to happen, you're going to smell something really bad. So the same thing with people that you associate yourself from Ramadan. Are you going to associate yourself with people who are going to pull you to watch TV, play card, spend your nights wasting your time and doing nothing, and you convincing yourself you're doing something good? Or are you going to associate yourself with people who are going to help you achieve higher, inshallah ta'ala, in the month of Ramadan? As a recommendation, look for one or two people in the month of Ramadan. Those who are going to be very high achievers, and associate yourself with them, inshallah ta'ala, throughout the month of Ramadan as much as you can. Have good companions around you, and hopefully, inshallah, you will achieve as much as they achieve, not even more than that. Point number seven. When you start your achievement, you're going to need to go all out and work so hard on it. So when you set your goals, you're not going to set your goals to just to achieve these goals at your convenience or whenever you have spare time for these goals. That's not going to work. If you are serious about achieving these goals in Ramadan, you're going to have to make them priority. And you go all the way out there to achieve these goals. Very lofty goals. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever the Prophet used to go out to do his da'wah, he will definitely, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, spend his effort in inviting as many people as he can to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one would achieve better than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one can claim that even they achieve more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, when he comes home, you expect him now to get some rest, to relax, so he will rejuvenate and go move on to the next level afterwards. The instruction that came to him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is completely the opposite. Allah tells him subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَى رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ. That when you're done, which means when you're done doing your da'wah work outside, he didn't tell him to go and take a nap, get some rest. He says, فَانْصَبْ, put yourself until you get tired. Put yourself in worship and ibadah until you get tired. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he always maintained Qiyamul Layl in every single night. He always maintained Qiyamul Layl, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And it's something amazing. With all the work he does during the day, he still needed to do more, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, during the night. For what reason? To get to the next level. People who go to the gym and they work out, they know what the meaning of these words, because whenever you achieve your 10 reps, for example, you're going to need to add now one more. You get more excited by this extra one than the whole entire hour of preparation. Why? Because you passed your regular achievements. And that's exactly how it should go during the month of Ramadan. You need to put your goals straight. And you move on to achieve these goals and put yourself and put a priority during the day, inshallah, in Ramadan, and during the night as well. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even, he's recommending, he's reminding us all the time how to move on from one level to the other. One time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during the month of Ramadan, as everybody was preparing for it, the Prophet, he told them that there is one night in the month of Ramadan, whoever achieves that night, he has achieved Laylatul Qadr, which is better than 1,000 months, worship of 1,000 months. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, they were worshipping in Ramadan in a hope to achieve this night. Then the Prophet is moving them to the next level. He said, if you want to look for Laylatul Qadr, then look for it in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. So the Sahaba now, they're becoming more focused. Although now it's the end of the season, you expect people to have fatigue and being so tired and exhausted and now starting getting ready to end the program, so that basically they become more relaxed. To help them achieve higher achievements, Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, he instructed them that night you're looking for is actually in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. But then people now, somehow some of them start getting a little bit lazy and tired. To help them achieve higher and more, the Prophet ﷺ said, if you want to achieve this night, it's going to be in the witr of the night, which means the odd numbers, the 21st, 23rd, 25th. Now there is more focus. There are 5 nights right now you're going to be focusing on. And then on top of all of this, the Prophet ﷺ said it would be one of these nights that might be the 27th. Sometimes he tells him it's 25th. Sometimes he tells him it's 23rd specifically. So the point here is the Prophet ﷺ is asking the people, every time you feel now your momentum is now it's receding and going down, you need to build up higher momentum by becoming more focused. To go out there and focus more hours, more time, more nights for the worship. And that's what does it mean to go all out and work so hard, because that happens only once a year. And only Allah knows if you're going to even survive today until we get to Ramadan in a few days from now. Only Allah knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So make this Ramadan, that is coming Ramadan, the best Ramadan by being more focused, inshallah, and put so much effort in achieving better goals in the month of Ramadan. Be prepared and be adaptable. Be prepared basically to change that schedule. Many people, whenever they come to me with a schedule, a program, they say, I start, alhamdulillah, very effectively the first few days, but then slowly and gradually, I feel that I'm kind of losing it. And eventually when I start losing it, basically, I don't really feel that I've done a great job. So I try to start over again, and I feel now that I'm losing momentum completely, then they become kind of desperate. So you know what, that's it, I can't do it. So instead of changing their schedule slightly, they try to start over from the beginning with a complete new schedule. They try that once again, it's not working for them at all, so they quit. And that is wrong. Expect yourself to change plans during the month of Ramadan. It's not going to be a dramatic change perhaps, but you need to expect that you need to adapt to the change even during the month of Ramadan. That is better for you than completely quitting the program over and over again and lose hope and lose heart completely. Even the Prophet ﷺ, he starts his day with specific plans, but then he changed his plan based on circumstances. One time the Prophet ﷺ, he entered the house of Ummahat al-Mu'mineen and he asked him, he says, is there any food? Which means he wants to have breakfast. If they tell him there is no food, he says, okay then, I'll fast. SubhanAllah, I mean the Prophet, he could just go out and look food somewhere else. But he says, you know what, I'll use the opportunity inshallah to fast. So you can expect yourself to change some of these plans. And again, you need to change that when there are some emergencies. We know that you're going to have some emergencies. Never put your program back to back, so crowded. Some people, they put sessions back to back, become so crowded that when there's an emergency, they're going to have to break off the whole program actually, and they will never be able to restore that afterwards. So expect yourself to do some changes. That makes it actually less stressful for you. So if you have done, alhamdulillah, ba'amin khatmat al-Qur'an, you start from the beginning by doing 5 juz every single night. But then you realize after 2-3 days, 5 juz are too much. The second night you only did 3. So now you are short 2 juz plus 5. Next day you talk about 7. You want to be able to achieve 7. So you know what, this is going to be actually very hard work. As you try to do your 7, you barely did 2. So now you start accumulating all this extra work on you, and then you lose heart, you lose hope. Expect yourself to adapt for change. 5 is too much for you because it's not realistic at all, then adapt to do 3. But then stick to it. Now that you know you are able to do 5 the first night, that means you can do 5. But you might not be able to do it every single night, so you better do something reasonable every single night, like doing 3. And stick to that and move on with your schedule. Do not completely cancel the good deed that you have started simply because you're thinking that you're falling behind too much. Try to adjust and adapt more, inshallah ta'ala, to the new change that might happen in your life. You might fall sick. Someone in the family might actually fall ill. You might have an emergency to travel. Some relatives might come to visit and they stay, for example, a few days at home. So it becomes kind of different to achieve all these goals that you have set for yourself. Expect to change some of your plans and adapt, inshallah, that change and embrace it in a nice way, in a positive way, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Point number nine, remind yourself of the virtue of what you are doing. You know, one of the best things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind means teach that message for teaching it benefits the believers. Remind, for the reminder really benefits the believers. And you yourself during the month of Ramadan, you are going to feel a little bit tired, exhausted. One way of doing that, to go to someone whom you think can help you, remind yourself by asking, you know, I need advice from you. I've done, alhamdulillah, so far that much. I'm feeling a little bit tired. Could you please help me? I need advice from you. So have someone remind you. You yourself, if no one else is reminding you, you yourself remind yourself by sitting a few minutes at night in seclusion and start making dhikr and dua and start remembering what Allah is preparing for the fasting person. And here in this point comes reading about the virtues of fasting. Every now and then, keep that hand in your hand. I know for many people it becomes like a cliche. Why? Because we know what's the virtue of fasting. We know the virtue of Ramadan. Yeah, but the reminder definitely benefits the believer. So keep Riyadu Salihin handy. Keep the hadith about the fasting of the month of Ramadan and the virtue of fasting one day for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the virtue of the nights of Ramadan. Keep it handy. Every time you feel weak, you feel exhausted, you're falling a little bit behind, come and remind yourself. Read that inshaAllah ta'ala, and hopefully bidnillah that rejuvenates inshaAllah your spirit. If that wasn't sufficient for you, go and look for somebody else. Have someone give you advice to remind you. If that doesn't help either, then eventually go and attend a powerful reminder in a masjid. Go and attend a program in a masjid that will revive you, help you revisit your goals and remind you inshaAllah for the virtue of fasting, and inshaAllah ta'ala increase your spirit to continue during the month of Ramadan. Number 10, the last point in the art of excelling in the month of Ramadan is never give up. Never give up. If the shaitan, he wants anything from us human beings, children of Adam, he wants us to give up on ourselves first and foremost. People, they see that on a regular basis. Every time they start making their ibadah, and then they stop doing it, and then they try to do it again, they feel kind of weak to do it. Slowly and gradually, the shaitan whispers to them, telling them, you can't do it, you know that. He starts whispering to them, you're not that person to achieve these kind of good deeds. So then eventually you believe in that, and you give up on doing these good deeds. How many times you vowed after Ramadan to wake up for Qiyamul Layl regularly, and you never achieved it? How many times you talk to yourself that you're going to start fasting after Ramadan continuously, inshallah, Mondays and Thursdays, or at least 3 days in every month, but you were unable to achieve or commit to that, what you've actually asked yourself to do? So how many times, and then eventually you reach a point where you gave up? Says, you know, I know myself, I will not be able to do that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ Surah Yusuf itself, which has the story of Surah Yusuf, إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that never give up basically hope of Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's mercy, truly no one despairs of Allah's soothing mercy except those who have no faith. If you have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should never give up. And you should never cancel your programs and cancel your plans in the month of Ramadan simply because you felt a little bit short or you felt kind of weak a little bit. Even until the last breath, and then the last even second in this world, before Yawm al-Qiyamah, you are required and asked to do something that is good. The Prophet ﷺ says in Hadith Anas radiallahu ta'ala, which is in Muslim Imam Ahmad and other books of Hadith, قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ سَلَّمْ إِنْ قَامَتِ السَّاعَةِ If the day of judgment was established, وَفِي أَدِي أَحَدِكُمْ فَسِيلًا And in your hand you have a plant, they were about to put in the land. You're plowing the earth and you're prepared to plant something for the future. You know it's a day of judgment already. Who's going to benefit from this anyway? In your mind, who's going to benefit from that? But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will benefit from it. Just put it there. The Prophet says, فَإِنْ اسْتَطَاعَ أَلَّا تَقُومَ حَتَّى يَغْرِسْهَا فَلْيَغْرِسْهَا If you were able to put it there in the earth, in the land, in the earth, before the Day of Judgment completely starts bursting and erupting completely, then do it. And I'm asking each and every one of you, even if it was the last second of the month of Ramadan, remember that night, last night of the month of Ramadan last year? What were you doing? People, they were getting ready and prepared just to finish the day, the month of Ramadan, prepared for the Eid. They want just to start celebrating, they know that tomorrow they're going to be eating, they're not going to be fasting and so on. But it's one of these blessed nights and blessed actually moments. That's when you need to focus on dua, dhikr, making charities, because once Ramadan is over, that's it, the season is gone. Whatever you do afterwards is not going to be multiplied as much as will be multiplied in the month of Ramadan. So never give up. When you have a plan and a strategy and good alhamdulillah, a good actually goal you've established for yourself, never give up. Even if you fall short and you fall behind, keep going on and keep continuing. As inshaAllah ta'ala Ramadan continues, you should also continue by doing good deeds until the end of the month of Ramadan. Even if it was the last night, don't say, well, I've already wasted 29 nights. It doesn't matter. Make this night be your best night. Even if it was the last hour of the month of Ramadan and you still haven't finished khatmah of the Quran, Don't say, I can't do it anyway. Even if you couldn't do it anyway, but at least you could do close to a khatma. So you're going to fall short maybe one juz, two juz. That's better than 15 juz. Ramadan. Because remember, you're dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is the one who rewards. So for you, if you now start measuring it in terms of dunya, you say that's not worth it. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is absolutely worth every effort that you do. These are the 10 points on how you can, inshallah ta'ala, excel in the month of Ramadan. To recap these points with you, I'm going to go over them real quick, inshallah ta'ala. So, remember that it's never too late to prepare for Ramadan. And also remember that you will never be too ready for the month of Ramadan. So the best way of doing it, at least, to prepare yourself by planting some principles in your mind and your heart. So when Ramadan begins, inshallah ta'ala, at least you have something to achieve. Number one, have the hunger of success. The first thing is you need to have that ardent desire to succeed in Ramadan. Do you have that? Or do you stop like every single year that, you know, like every single Ramadan, I know myself, I'm not a good achiever, I'm not a strong achiever, so I just go with just like every single year. No. Expect to succeed more, inshallah ta'ala. Have that hunger for success. Number two, since Ramadan is coming, set your goals. And when you set your goals, set them very high. Allah has set your goal higher than what you can imagine. Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. His satisfaction with you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, his pleasure. That's the highest goal. So he's already helping you set your goals high for yourself in Ramadan. So go and try to achieve these goals, inshallah ta'ala. Number three, to build confidence that you can achieve these goals. Build confidence in Ramadan. Don't always just keep blaming yourself and beating yourself down. Always build confidence that you can achieve, and if you fail once, that doesn't mean you are a failure. You can achieve better, inshallah ta'ala. Number four, do what you love in Ramadan. Since there is a variety and diversity in good deeds in Ramadan, and you know you might not be able to achieve everything, at least start by achieving that which you like. If you're the type of person who loves to feed people, then cook and give away. If you like to give charity, then give more, inshallah ta'ala. If you're the type of person who likes to read the Quran, like to spend more time in the masjid, do what you love the most, inshallah ta'ala, and achieve that. Number five, study the successful and learn from the best. Go and read the stories of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Read about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Read about the Salaf al-Salih rahimahumullahu ta'ala and how much they have achieved during the month of Ramadan, and set them as example for you. Learn from them and learn their techniques. Number six, be in the company of successful one. What you learn from the stories of the Salihin is something you might consider theoretical because you don't see that in real life. So in order to help you achieve that in real life, you need to associate yourself with good company. Seek one or two people who are higher achievers in Ramadan and associate yourself from them. And remember that habits are contagious. If you associate yourself with good ones, high achievers, most likely you achieve higher in Ramadan. But if you associate yourself with low achievers, most likely that's what you can achieve in Ramadan. Number seven, go all out and work so hard on it. Because this is once in perhaps maybe in your lifetime right now. It could be your last Ramadan. It happens only once every year. You might not be able to survive until next year. Allahu ta'ala alam. Only Allah knows. So make this opportunity like your first and your last opportunity. What would you do? Definitely you're going to do the best. And you're going to put every single effort you can afford in order to make this success, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Particularly, of course, in the last 10 nights in Ramadan. Number eight, be adaptable. Expect change in plans. As you try to achieve your plans, you might fall into some mistakes. Some emergencies, some come up actually in your schedule that might hold you back from achieving what you have been doing earlier in the month. That doesn't mean to quit the plan, rather try to adapt a new change and start moving on, inshallah, based on the new change in your plan. But never cancel that schedule, never cancel your program. Number nine, remind yourself of the virtue of what you're doing. That's when you always keep handy the book of virtues and the books of the virtues of fasting. You read about Ramadan, about fasting in general, about al-i'tikaf, about staying in the masjid, about feeding others Remind yourself of the virtue of what you are achieving, and remember that the best thing that you remember is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Hadith al-Qudsi, that كُلُّ عَمَلِ ابْنِ آدَمَ لَهُ إِلَّا الصَّلْ. All the good deeds ibn Adam is doing, it's for himself. Except for fasting, فَإِنَّهُ لِي. Fasting is done exclusively for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ, and I shall give reward for it. So if you know that Allah is the one who's giving the reward, how much you should expect from Allah? Definitely among and beyond your imagination. And number 10, never ever give up. Never give up. Even if it was the last hour in the month of Ramadan, make sure to use it wisely. Make sure to use it inshallah ta'ala by achieving the greatest achievement you can afford during the month of Ramadan. These are 10 points on how you can excel in the month of Ramadan inshallah ta'ala. And with that, I wish you bi-idhnillahi azza all of you a successful Ramadan this year. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this Ramadan the best Ramadan for all of you. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us all live until we live this Ramadan bi-idhnillah, to make our fast the best fast, our qiyam the best qiyam, and to help us inshallah to become more generous in the month of Ramadan. I ask Allah azza to help us all at least achieve some of the i'tikaf during the last few nights of the month of Ramadan. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us be among those people who will survive and live, and they will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Laylatul Qadr, it is better for them than 1,000 months of worship. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will learn the benefit knowledge, and inshallah to benefit from it and benefit others. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. عَبْدُ اللَّهِ.